I want to talk to you today about who we are. Who are we as a church? You know, I believe that 2017, we will see supernatural growth. Not natural growth, supernatural. So I want to talk to you today about receiving, preparing a place that is ready to receive people in. Now, one of the shared values that we have in this church is we value excellence. So we do everything as best as we can. Pastor Bradford, who I was trained under, really would demand excellence. And so that got into my DNA. And so I'm not saying that we do everything perfectly around here, but we try to do everything we can. We try to have the lights right, the sound right. When we designed this, we tried to do it and think about just all kinds of details. You know what? The drum room, the sound, the cables. All the cables are run through the soffit box. The design. I mean, very trying to be thought through and trying to do it right with excellence. Everything we try to do is with excellence. That's one of our shared values. But here's what we can do. Guys in the back, I need you a couple things. I need you to be ready to do the video, and I want the welcome signs up right now. So here's what we can do. Here's what I want to talk to you about. I want you to talk about what the Bible talks about is not judging others. Everybody say, don't judge others. See, that's what God says. Jesus says it, James says it, throughout the Bible, we're not to judge others. And I'll go over, because the first service kind of set the foundation. Second service, I'm going to go a little detail, a little deeper. But I want you to catch all this. But here's what we can do. We have this up here, boom, welcome. We're glad you're here. And so somebody comes in and they're like, oh, yes. You know what? But we can have that on the screens, but we can come off sometimes unwelcoming. And let me tell you how we do that. We do that by being self-righteous. We do that by this, and it's subtle, but how many know it doesn't come off subtle to people? How many know people who have issues, and how many know everybody has issues, a lot of times they're real sensitive as they are feeling like directed by God into a church, but they're feeling very self-conscious about their issues. Hello. Remember how you felt the first time you came?
Yeah.
Okay. And so I want to talk about that. So we can have this welcoming in our signs, but in our attitude come off non-welcoming. And listen. And before you say, no, not me, let me teach you a story in the Bible that Jesus taught somebody, and maybe, just maybe, the Holy Spirit will speak to you and say, actually, you are self-righteous in some areas. I'm just asking, who's open to allowing the Holy Spirit to convict today? Now, but before we get started, I want to just give you a visual of this. Guys, run the video, if you could.
She is running 100 miles an hour in the wrong direction. She is trying, but the canyon's ever widening in the depths of her cold heart. So she sets out on another misadventure just to find she's another 2 years older and she's three more steps behind. Does anybody hear her? Can anybody see? Or does anybody even know she's going down today? Under the shadow of our steeple, with all the lost and lonely people searching for the hope that's tucked away in you and me. Does anybody hear her? Can anybody see? Shelter and affection that she never found at home. And she is searching for a hero to ride in and save the day. And in walks a Prince Charming. Every steeple, if lofty glances from lofty people, you can't see past a scarlet letter, and we've never even met her. If judgment looms under every steeple, if lofty glances from lofty people, can't see past a scarlet letter, and we've never
So here's the deal. So here's the deal. That's us. I don't say that in a negative way. I don't say that you're not, you're self-righteous. I'm not, I'm saying me or the girl. And we have got to create an atmosphere where people will come and not feel judged and not feel condemned because of who they are. That's how Jesus acted. And so what we can do, and let me just teach it to you, because you're not bad people. Good people. And you love God. You're in this spiritual journey that you're walking through. Let me just ask. How many of you, when you first came in this church, you know what? You were all jacked up. And so here's what happens. You come to the church and you've got issues. And everybody's got issues. And you come to the church and you hear the word. Because let me tell you, at Hope, we're going to teach the word, because the word is Jesus, and Jesus is what's going to set you free. Jesus, the Bible says God sent the word to heal us. Jesus is the healer. He'll heal you. He'll heal your broken heart. He'll heal your body. He'll restore your marriage. He fixes things. And he does that, you know what? First, you accept him in your heart, and then there's this process of changing your mind. Because let me tell you why you've done. Has anybody done stupid things in your life? Raise your hand. And things that you did and you were like, why did I do that? Am I the only one who's done something? And after they did it, they said, why did I do that? It was so dumb. I mean, you know it, because you know it's going to mess up your life. We've all done that. What's the problem? The problem is our mind. We are not conformed to the world, but we're transformed by the renewing of the mind. And here's what happens. And you came in and you were all jacked up. And you know what? And you heard the word of God and it convicted you and it changed a portion of your mind. Something, some area, you know what? Whatever that area was that was messed up, you heard it and you were like, oh my goodness, Pastor, how did you know? I didn't know. Yeah, but you were looking right at me. I wasn't looking at you. You just thought I was. Amen. But you heard it, and you thought, man, that is right. And you submitted to the word, and you started changing your actions, and your actions, your behavior. You thought different, and then you acted different, and then you sowed different, and then you had a benefit from that. And for many of you, you've been coming here and the changes just keep on happening and you keep on learning and you're changing and you're not the person that you used to be back here. I mean, no, that's a good thing. But here's what happens subtly. You're not bad people, but we have to teach this because it happens so subtly. And then somebody comes in and you, well, go to my, oh, you don't have my definition. Let me give you my definition of judgment. Judgment is this, it's a negative assessment of another person. Let's say that together. A negative assessment of another person based upon a superficial sense of superiority. See, you were back here, but you're not back here anymore. Now you're here. And because you're here, you have this tendency to look at somebody who's back there with this superiority. And listen, I love you guys. We can't do that. Can I tell you a story in the Bible? It's in Luke chapter 7. and there's this guy, and he's a Pharisee. Pharisees were like, not good. Because here's why. Because they did that. They judged everyone. They had the outside clean, but the inside was a mess. And that's not good. But this Pharisee asks, he invites Jesus over to his house. Jesus, who does not judge, says, yeah, I'll go over. It's not like, I'm not going to your house. You're a Pharisee. No, I'm here to minister to sinners, and I'll go. So he goes. When he gets there, there's this woman, and the Bible says she's a woman from the city. Now, when the Bible says this woman from the city, it's not trying to describe that she's not from the country. It's describing that she is a prostitute. That's what it's saying. So this prostitute comes in, and the Bible says the prostitute comes behind him. Let me just teach you some things. In that culture, back in that day, no air conditioning. So they're going to have a meal, sometimes very hot. We're going to get heat. What does heat do? Rises. So we're going to get close to, so we're not going to eat, you know, on these high tables. We're going to chill out. You know what I mean? So there, many times they would eat lying down. And so that's what's going on. This lady comes in behind him, not even invited, comes in behind him and starts weeping. Can I say this? In the presence of God, you start to recognize where you're at spiritually. What's his name? Anyway, I'll remember his name in a minute. But Smith Wigglesworth used to get on a train, and people would repent. Just say, I'm convicted of my sin, and just shout out their sin. And just fall down and just pray for me. What's going on? Here's what's going on. Smith Wigglesworth spent some time with God. And in the presence of God, people are convicted of sin. This lady, and understand this, this lady wasn't, men, you understand. You ever watch a movie and you're like, no, I'm macho, I'm not crying. But you're in your eye duct, you're tearing up. And you start to blink. And if you kind of hold it together long enough, the tear won't even come out. Pastor, I don't know what you're talking about. Okay, that's fine. I'm cool. Okay. But that wasn't what was happening. Can you hear what was happening with her? She is crying so much that she's able, so much water is coming out of her eyes that she's able to wash the feet of Jesus. And then she's, get the picture. And she's wiping her. You ever spilled something? And you quickly look for some napkins. Okay. She's crying so much that she's wetting his feet. And then she's wiping it with her hair. Let me quickly. Wow is right. And the Pharisee who's invited Jesus over to his house, how does he act? Here's what the Bible says that he says. He says, oh my goodness. If Jesus was really prophetic, then he would know that this woman, this prostitute, unbelievable. She is kissing his feet. Ugh. Okay. And Jesus is going to take this time and have a coaching moment with this guy. Jesus is going to take this time and have a coaching moment with us today. Because here's what he does. He says, you know what, let me tell you what. His name was Simon. Simon, look at this woman. Now when he says, look at this woman, he's not saying, Simon, he's not asking Simon, are you blind? You know what I mean? He's not saying that. He knows Simon's not blind. So he's saying, Simon, you see this woman, but you don't see this woman. We make judgments on people. Well, you're like this. You're like that. You're like this. Well, you know what I mean? And here's what we think. We have no idea what's going on in their life. See, somebody comes in and maybe they're not the friendliest. And you say, hi, how you doing? You know what I mean? They're like, and they're just kind of reserved. And you walk away thinking, man, what a snob. Not even friendly. Here's what you don't know. You know what? You don't know. Can I get real with somebody? You have no idea that young lady has been abused by her parents. You know what? Her dad abused her. Her mom looked away. You know what I mean? During all the abusing, it took place for years and years and years. And you know what? Yeah, she's not the most friendly person. But she came to our church. And you're judging her on not being friendly. You have no idea. I'm smiling, right? And you have no idea what you're talking about. But you're going to walk away and judge her when you, what you ought to do is say, oh my goodness. What? Guys, we got a drip going on? Coaching moment here. Right? What you doing, man? Can't you see I'm preaching? You see how easy it's not? I would like to say I planned that. I didn't plan it. But if we're going to be a church that's really going to reach out, we've got to not do that. We've got to have a willingness to look at people and see them. That's what he's saying to Simon. Simon, I know you can see, but you're not looking. Let me tell you about this woman. This woman, I came into your house, you know what, and you didn't even provide any water for me to wash my feet. You know what? You didn't anoint my head. You know what? This woman is washing my feet with her tears. She's wiping it with her hair. Don't you see how, watch this, how awesome this lady is? You don't see it. Okay. So, but Pastor, I thought you taught us to we don't judge the world, but we judge those who are inside the church. Okay, well, that's what Paul says, and that's right. But let me teach you what God's talking about. But we are never judgmental towards anyone, even people in the church. And the Bible says if we do bring correction, we do it with a spirit of humility, lest the very thing that they're going on is going to come upon us. I mean, no, pride comes before a fall. And if we are correcting, we get the log out of our eye before we get the speck out of his brother's eye. What Jesus is saying when he says, don't judge, here's what he's saying. Don't be critical ever. Don't have a critical spirit. Christians ought not to have a critical spirit. Christians ought to have a loving spirit like Jesus Christ did. Are you learning something? Okay, so let me go over some real quick. Guys in the back, you got to follow me. Go to James chapter 2, verse 13. James chapter 2, verse 13. For judgment is without mercy to the one who shows no mercy. How many want mercy? What's mercy? Mercy is when you don't get what you deserve. How many want not get what you deserve? Anyone? Okay. Well, judgment is without mercy to the one who shows no mercy. Wow. That's intense, is it not? See, and yeah, thank you, Paul. Mercy triumphs over judgment. You know, what leads people to repentance? The goodness of God, the love of God. You know what? That's what leads people. That's the mercy triumphs over judgment. Be merciful to people. Be gracious to people. All right. So let's go over some practical things. What does that mean, not to judge? Well, I've got a good list that we're going to quickly go through. Number one, never judge broadly. Never judge broadly. Never judge. That means don't judge from far away. You know what I mean? Well, let me tell you what. Joyce Meyer? Let me tell you about her. You know how many, I don't know, you know what? Let me just tell you what. Joyce Meyer catches so much junk, you know what I mean? And let me tell you about Joyce Meyer. Joyce Meyer sets people free through the power of teaching the Word of God. Amen? I'm not saying I agree with everything she says. I'm just saying that woman preaches the uncompromised Word of God. Amen? Well, no. Yeah, but she... Are you kidding me? What are you doing? You're judging from far away. You know what I mean? Never. This happens all the time. You know what? You're standing, you're watching a ball game, you're in the stadium. You know what? The referee makes a call, and you're like, yeah, boo! You didn't even see it. And then they show it in slow motion, and you go, oh my goodness, it was right. He was safe.
Oh, there it is.
Right? How many times has this happened? Why? Well, here's why. Because where's the ump? The ump's like, have you seen these guys? They're like this. They're watching the whole thing. Like the first baseman. I don't know if you know this. You know what they're doing? They're listening to when the ball hits the first baseman's glove. They're listening. You're up there in the stand. Like you can hear that. They're looking at his foot and they're listening. And you think you're right. Why? Because you're judging it from way back. I don't know. Oh, my goodness. You don't know. I'm smiling, right? We don't know nothing. Look at your neighbor and say, you don't know anything. But do it with a smile, okay? You don't know nothing. Don't judge from afar. Don't judge from afar. Look what 1 Peter 4:17 says. 1 Peter 4:17. 1 Peter 4:17. For the time has come for judgment to begin in the house of God. If it begins with us first, what will be the end? See, what is it? First, what you know about. Close. Don't judge. Number one, don't judge broadly. Number two. Okay, can I tell you what? If you get any of my points, get this one. Are you ready? Never judge motives. Can you say never? Now, let me tell you when I mean never. I mean never. Never. Let me tell you why he did this. Let me tell you why she did this. Never judge motive. Never judge motive. Give people the benefit of the doubt. Why? Because you don't know motive. You don't know. But you're going to act like you know. Romans chapter 14, verse 10. But why do you judge your brother, or why do you show contempt for your brother? Contempt. Listen, let me tell you why they did this. Are you catching the contempt? Let me tell you why they did this. Guys, we don't know. You don't know. I don't. For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. But my mom said, worry about yourself, man. You don't know. I see this big ministry on TV. Won't tell you what ministry it is. And don't try to guess. Big minister on TV. I'm going to try to guess. Did I say don't try to guess? So, big ministry. And they have these grand sets. So, the ministry is preaching on, one time they were talking about building the kingdom of God. And so they had all this sand. I mean, huge stage, and they had built all these sandcastles. You ever see professional sandcastle builders? I mean, just like, woo! You know what I mean? One time I was watching, and the true story, really big stage, and they had brought in all this dirt, and they had two motorcycles guys, and had this, and these motorcycles guys are going up, doing a flip. I mean, it was bad. It was awesome. It was totally cool. But you know what? But what did I do? I'm like, how much money did it cost to do that? What do I know? I know nothing. For all I know, a gentleman came who works in Hollywood. He understands how powerful a set can be. And he says, you know what? I'm a millionaire, and I will pay for 4 sets. Any series that you do in a year, I will build a set for that. Would you like that? I'm writing the check. What does the pastor do? No. That would be foolishness, guys. But I, in Pico Rivera, you know what? Pastoring this church is going to go, I know their motive. What do I know? Come on, help me out. What do I know? I know nothing. I know nothing. Show me the picture of the doors. Yeah, I'm not asking for a picture of Jim Morrison. Okay. Okay. And don't even ask me to sing Jim Morrison, because I'm not going to do it. Okay. So anyway, so watch this. So. That's a nice picture. You have no idea how awesome those doors are. Those doors, I don't know, is Fernando in the room? Where's Fernando? Okay. I don't know. Those doors are so tall that Paul can go through those doors and not have to bend down. But, so in the foyer, we used to have the foyer. Foyer is just this little room between the outside and the inside over in the north sanctuary. It was such a dorky room. They had built this this ceiling on it, put popcorn on there. I had no idea it was up there. I just one day just got mad at the design, and I said, I don't even know what's up there, but we're going to tear it off. We tore it off, and there's this cool post coming down. Cool, I mean, just incredible design there. Plus, we got some height. Well, when we did that, then I, here's my point. Oh, they shouldn't spend so much money on those doors. Here, right back at you. Okay, all I'm saying is, you know what? Here's the reality. I went to Monrovia. We're picking somebody up from the airport. It was like 4 in the morning. My wife, let me tell you what, you should love my wife. My wife is the hardest worker I have ever known. She just, and anyway, so she's relentless in building the kingdom. We picked somebody up from the airport or dropped somebody off from the airport. We're coming back. It's 4:30 in the morning. She's like, let's go to Home Depot. Like, woman, are you crazy? You know what I mean? She's like, well, there'll be nobody there. I'm like, yeah, that's true. But you know what? They're not even open. She's like, no, I think Monrovia is open at 5:00 in the morning. We show up at 5:00 in the morning. I see those doors. Those doors are 75% off. Those doors are 250. $1,016. They're on sale for $253. And I'm like, I like a deal. I'm like, that is a deal. I like those doors. So we don't buy those doors, but I come home. I'm like, honey, you know what? We should get those doors for the church. My mother's like, well, where are you going to put them? I don't know, but we should buy them, man. I told you I like a deal. And I love those doors. I'm like, I don't know where we're going to put them, but let's buy them. You know what I mean? So Then Pastor Paul and I were there. I forget what I was picking up. I had his truck. It wouldn't fit. I had the van. It wouldn't fit. I called Pastor Paul. Pastor Paul's gracious, rescues me, comes with his truck. You know what? And I'm standing there, and I'm waiting for him to come. And guess what I'm looking at? The doors. And they're 75% off. They're 200 something regular, over $1,000. And I'm looking at the doors, and I'm looking at them, and just kind of dripping the saliva out of my mouth because I just love these doors. And the guy comes up, and he says, and he starts to take the door. I'm like, you know what? Where are you taking those? He says, oh, we're you know what? Those didn't sell. We're going to take those back to the main hub or whatever. I'm like, can you leave those for a minute? Can I talk to a manager? Manager came out. How many know your pastor's bold? So he comes out and I say, hey, we're a nonprofit. Can you give us those doors? How many know that's even a better discount? I say, hey, can you give us, because you're just going to, you know what I mean? Can you give us those doors? And he goes, well, I probably can't. He said, I'll give them to you for $100. How many know $100 is better than $253? And how many know $253 is a lot better than $1,016? Listen, but when you go over there, you know what you're going to see? You're going to go in there and you're going to see $1,016 doors hanging up. And let me tell you what, it is so, because you know how high the ceiling is. Listen, that is appropriate and it looks stunning. And we haven't even painted them the right color yet. Wait till we're done. It's stunning. Well, what's my point? I could give you story after story after story of situations where you're going to make a judgment. Listen, and you reap what you sow. Listen, is God happy with me? God is smiling at me. Watch this. Let me teach you something. So you are judging that as pastor was extravagant. I would say this. You look at how they built the temple. Be careful before you judging on extravagance of a church building. Somebody shout me down. Number one, but number two, watch what's going to happen. You're going to see I know those doors were at least $1,000, and you're going to judge me for being a bad steward, and God is smiling on me for being a good steward. See, Simon, will you look at her? Will you see what's really going on? Will you look at the work ethic that goes in and that Pastor Drew, do you know that Pastor Drew, you know what, was bivocational for most of the time that he was here at the church and didn't cry in his Cheerios, had another job? Why? Because the church wasn't in a place they could support even one-time, full-time person. And he just smiled and thanked God that God had called him or not. Hello? See, and what am I saying? It's not about me. It's about whatever the judgment is. You're not called to judge, you know what, things you don't have a clue about. And we all do it. But we need to not do it if we're going to receive what God's going to bring into us. Is this making sense? Okay, quickly, number three. Never judge quickly. Quickly, never judge quickly. Okay? Right? 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 5. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 5. What does it say? Therefore, judge nothing before the time. You don't know. You think you know, you don't know. James chapter 1, verse 19. James chapter 1, verse 19. So then, beloved brethren, so you're talking to Christians. Let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. Well, let me tell you. No, no, no. Why? 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 Here's why. Because you're going to judge something. You're going to judge it wrongly. And now you're going to be under, there's going to be consequences for you not doing what Jesus said. Hello? Look. For the wrath of man doesn't produce the righteousness of God. And let's put it in context of this church. How are we supposed to receive these people? We're making judgments on these people. Listen, in that story, it's interesting because in that story, Jesus says, you know what, says to Simon, hey, Simon, I got a question. This guy, there's two guys, and one guy owes this guy a bunch of money, and one guy owes this guy not so much money. But the guy says, I forgive you both. Who's going to love him more? Simon says, the one who owns the most. God says, Simon, you judge rightly. And then he starts talking about this woman and says, look at this woman. See, we look at Simon and we look at the prostitute. And for us, most of us say, oh, yeah, that prostitute, she was the one who's jacked up. Can I tell you what? Wrong. She was the one. They were both jacked up. Completely jacked up, both of them. But she recognized she was jacked up. That's the difference. And when you recognize that God has forgiven you from so much, it changes your judgment on other people. You're not even watching. You're not even paying attention. You're just like, man, we're glad you're here. Hello? Amen? Quickly. You don't even know that problem. Let me tell you what. I know, you know what, and you assess based on God judges inwardly. Man judges outwardly. Is that not right? That's what First Peter, what First Samuel says. Man judges on outward appearance. God, well, let me tell you what I know, don't know. Can I tell you what gets God? Self-righteousness. Look into the Bible. Look at who Jesus gets upset with. He doesn't get upset with prostitutes. He gets upset with people who don't recognize how messed up they are. And those are the first people who judge other people. Number four, don't judge harshly. Again, James chapter 2, verse 13. James chapter 2, verse 13. Look what it says. For judgment without mercy is to the one who shows no mercy. Man, you don't want to judge harshly. You know what? Jesus said, with the same measure that you measure it out, that's how it's going to be measured back to you. Right? Luke, you know this. Luke chapter 6, verse 38. Luke chapter 6, verse 38. Give it and will be given down to you. Go. Can you guys go back to 37? 37. Judge not and you will not be judged. Condemn not and you will not be condemned. Forgive and it will be forgiven. What's the reciprocal of that? Guys, go back to 37. What's the reciprocal of that? If you judge, you know what? You won't be judged. If you condemn, you're going to be condemned. You're not merciful, God's not going to show you mercy. Man, I want to be merciful to people. Okay. Number five. Oh, this is good. Number five. Number one, you know what? Don't judge broadly. Number two, don't judge motives ever. Number three, you know, don't judge quickly. Number four, don't judge harshly. Number five. You guys got a number five? You don't have a number five. All right, I'm going to give you a number five. Are you ready? This is like the added bonus. Amen? Woo! I got bonus time. Amen? Okay. Here's your... What was that game that the guys came down and you had to shoot them up? Galaxy? Okay. I'm giving you extra time. Amen? Do you ever get extra time? You're like, yeah, I got extra time. Okay. I'm going to give you extra time. You ready? Number five. You get a number five today. Okay, number five. Okay, here it is. Ready? Never judge. That's deep, Pastor. No. Let me teach you what I mean by it. Guys, flow with me in the back if you can. Go to James chapter 4, verse 12. Never judge. Never. Okay. Now, here's what I mean by that. I mean, you never judge. You. Everybody say me. Never judge. Okay. Here's why. Because you're not the judge. There's one lawgiver. Now, do you think you're the lawgiver? No. Who's the lawgiver? God's the lawgiver. There's one lawgiver who's able to save and destroy you. Who are you to judge another? So, let's everybody say never judge. Now, somebody, here's what the world has turned that into. That means I can do whatever I want, and you're a Christian, you're not supposed to judge me. I'm sorry. Bad exegete of the scripture. Like, bad. Okay. Here's what that means. When God says, this is wrong, guess what? That's wrong. Yep. No. Yeah, but the Bible says don't judge. Exactly. Stop judging. We as a society say, this is okay. God says it's not okay. Society, we say, no, it is okay. No, hello? You can say it as much as you want. You can argue with him. Yes, it is. No, it's not. Yes, it is. God is not changing his mind. And here's the thing, and I've been old enough to experience this. When you just come up with your own stuff, then you have to deal with the consequences. How many know sin has consequences? So, don't judge. Here's what that means. When God says don't do it, don't do it. Don't judge it okay when God says that's wrong. What you ought to say is, that's wrong. Listen, as a church, we are not going to judge. I don't care what you've done. It doesn't make any difference. You know what? Here, I'm like you. I'm all jacked up like you. And maybe I'm not jacked up like back then, like I used to be, but I'm still jacked up. Amen. How many know God's working on? Okay. Listen. And this is for everyone. If you're in the same place, I've been going to church for 5 years. You know what I mean? Praise God. But I'm still as jacked up as I was the first day you came in. Oh, please. Can I help you? And having heard the word of God, I will do. Okay. If you do what God says, you're not going to stay there. Because his word will deliver you out of your mess. But here's what I want to say. Anybody who comes in, join the jacked up club. Now, you say, Pastor, wait, I don't understand what you're saying, because 2 weeks ago you said, you know what, identify with the Spirit. Remember Paul said, what I do, I don't do. When I sin, I don't do it. It's not me. Okay. I'm not changing my mind. Identify with the Spirit. You are a spirit. You've been born again. All things are passed away. Reckon yourself dead to sin. But listen. But Paul says this. He says, you know what? Out of a bunch of this stuff, Jesus saves. And let me tell you about me. I'm chief sinner. What you going to do with that? Well, and I didn't know what to do with that until I went to Luke 7. And God says, here's what I want you to do. I want you to identify with the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And I want you to recognize that you cannot be self-righteous as I am. And Paul is an example of someone not being self-righteous. See, let me teach you. Can I teach you one more thing, and then I gotta go? Okay. I don't have point six. Okay. Okay, I do have point six. Here's point six.
Yeah.
Okay, listen, and I'll close with this. We have to not judge people. And if we do, people are going to come and they're going to appreciate the non-judgment. And they're going to, you're going to see them for not, just like Jesus sees you, for not who they are, but who Jesus is going to make them. Here's what the Bible says. Are you ready for this? This is one of the toughest scriptures in the whole Bible. But you can handle. Here's what the Bible says. Put others in front of you, more important than you. So somebody comes in, and whatever they've been done in the past, you just say to yourself, oh, watch this. There, you just say to yourself, this is a word picture. They're better than me. If you say they are better than me, you won't judge. Here, let's say that together. They are better than me. Wow. Did you learn something today? Okay. How many, I'm just asking, how many would raise your hand and say, Pastor, I've done that sometimes. Let me define again. Not like 8 years ago. I did that recently. Father, you see the hands that went up. You know our hearts. Father, we thank you that the word convicts us and helps us and washes our mind. Father, we thank you that we see others better than ourselves. Say that with me. We see others better than ourselves. Wow. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen, 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 amen.
Teaching and guiding me through.